Party people, all right, let's get going. So my name is Gautier Demon. I am the VP in North America for Qwilt, for content provider. So the goal today is to kind of like share a little bit of the state of open caching, share the lesson we've learned this year, and hopefully do that within half an hour. And I tend to speak a lot, so hopefully you guys can give me hand side to shut up. All right, the other hard part is that I have no feedback on slides, so I'll look at the screen a little bit, and we'll get going from there. So let's talk a little bit about open caching. Open caching is a caching technology that was created by SVTA, that was designed and refined by SVTA. It's not only involving Qwilt, it's involving a lot of companies that work together to create a standard to provide better content delivery. Okay? There are two objectives. Was make sure they identify the critical component of a non-proprietary caching system, and secondly, establish guidelines as to what you need to do to design an efficient and top-level caching platform. All right? So what is the main difference between open caching, the way Qwilt is doing it, and regular caching? Well, if you look at regular caching, typically content is being delivered from data centers that are located all over the world. If we're talking about the US, all over the US. And then you use the connectivity that those data centers have to the ISP to reach the eyeballs. So it goes data center, peering point, ISP, eyeballs, all right? That system was working very well when we all started working in CDN. I mean, some of them have been working longer than I do, but I started in 2008. And what we've seen over the past few years is that access to eyeballs, that access to the ISP network have been the source of pain and outages, because now if you look at a typical Tuesday, you have at the same time the Microsoft Windows update that need to reach your computer. You have the iOS update with Apple. You have the Champions League. You have some other sporting events like the NBA and NHL at the same time. And all of that are trying to go through the same pipe to the same network. And basically you're seeing an overloading of those peering points, right? So that creates extra latencies, that creates lost packets, and that's not the most efficient way anymore to deliver content. What open caching does is that it partners with the ISP and deploy architecture deep inside the ISP network to a density and granularity that has not been done before. To give you an example, one of the first deployments that Qwilt did years ago was with Verizon here on the East Coast of the US. And only within Verizon ISP, we deployed 400 POPs, not servers, 400 POPs within the Verizon broadband network, right? And now with mobile, we added an extra 300 within Verizon for Verizon Mobile. So what that means is that you're typically sub 5 milliseconds to any user. You bypass the traditional bottleneck of the peering point because you're already within the network, right? Closer to the end user, and you can have more capacity and more efficiency delivering content, okay? Let's talk at the current state of open caching. So starting from that basic concept designed by SVTA, we started adding tools to make it as competitive as your traditional CDN, your AWS, your Akamai, your Fastly of the world. So that means adding more tools like a centralized control plane, the ability to control the caching, the ability to have observability and visibility about what's going on, not only internally but externally, being able to give content providers API and dashboards so that they can look at what's happening within their for their content, the bandwidth, the speed at which it's delivered, the quality at which it's delivered. And we're starting like with SVTA, once again, designing all those guidelines, doing more API, self-service API, observability API, capacity API. I'll come back to that in a second. But basically, you have that entire ecosystem of tools that have been added to the simple original idea. There's two type of deployment that we're still seeing within the within the open caching ecosystem. There's the one that I told you about, which is what Qwilt is doing, which is an open platform, which means that any content provider can sign a contract with us, like a very much traditional CDN, to deliver their contents. And then there's a second aspect of the open caching world, which is still the private deployment. Private deployment means that that deployment is going to be within an ISP for one particular service. It's not going to be open to other video streaming platforms that want to use that architecture, right? Here I use one of the examples. Broadpeak is one of those companies that deliver private architecture, so the ISP can typically do their own IPTV, proprietary IPTV delivery within their network, right? But it's not a platform that is open to the rest of content providers. So over the last 2 years, we had a significant ramp up of onboarding, right? If you look at today, we have signed four of the five largest media platforms on the planet, right? All based in the US. There's that one left that we're really working really hard to try to get, but 80% is not that bad within 2 years. And the value, why are those people using open caching? Well, the value that content providers see for their live event or their on-demand content is several. One, the latency, right? Sub 5 milliseconds, you're closer to the end user, so they get the video faster. That basically means that within our client-side analytics, your time to first frame, your rebuffering ratio, all those KPIs that you're going to measure are going to go down, increase based on the KPI, but it's going to be a better streaming experience. The second thing is the bypassing of the traditional bottleneck, the peering point. You're not competing with other people to get your traffic to the ISP's network. Right? Your content is already deep within their network, so it's ready to be consumed. The third one is the capacity guaranteed. So as I mentioned, when I have my traditional data center, I can build 2 terabits per second of capacity in my data center. If my pipe to Comcast is only 200 gigs, I only have 200 gigs available to deliver content. So if you tell me, can you do a 1 terabits per second NFL game? I'm going to be like, well, I have the capacity on my server, but I don't have the capacity into the Comcast network with my peering point. Open caching, by being deep inside the network, bypasses that issue. And basically, if you build like 2 terabits per second within Verizon, you have 2 terabits per second that you can use, all right? And that you can also guarantee contractually, which is the topic du jour, which is the ability to guarantee that at such time for specific event, you're going to have that capacity guaranteed in the contract. One of the examples of the benefit that we had over the last 24 months, 18 months actually, one of the use cases I want to talk about before getting into the lesson we learned is the NCTC. So NCTC, if you guys don't know, it's an association of smaller ISPs. There's more than 200 ISPs that are part of that association, and together, they represent more than 35 million households. This is the size in the US of Comcast, right? So those are all like Midwest mom and pop shop in Iowa, in Nebraska, all over typically the middle of the US. And we got approached by a very big sport league, three letters, that doesn't play with a round ball like soccer, the other kind of ball. They came to us and said, well, we have an issue with those parties, with those particular users, because their streaming experience is terrible. We don't have small connectivity. We don't have good connectivity to those smaller ISPs. We need help. Can you guys go build something that would allow us to deliver those Sunday games with the best quality possible to those guys specifically? So over 7 months, we popped more than 120 ISPs with a simple architecture. It was a single, most of the time because of their size, a single server that we deploy within each of those initially 120 ISPs. And that basically allowed, That basically allowed the following metrics improvement for that particular sports league when they were reaching those 35 million users within the US. By deploying caching architecture within the ISP closer to the end users, they saw a 55% improvement in buffering time. By the way, that's not over one game. We took the average of like 6 games, so 6 weeks of delivery, and we did the average to give those numbers. This was not like a one-time wonder. It's really over the course of a month and a half of measurement. 31% improvement for time to first frame, 13% improvement in average bitrate watch, and 9.4% improvement improvement in error rate. But basically, the value that content providers see is a drastic increase of their KPI to specific audiences that are that can be reached via open caching. All right? So one of the other things that they use us for, and I already touched base about that, was the ability to guarantee capacity. It's really important when you've acquired the right for the Champions League, for example, and you want to make sure, or you have like a political campaign, you have the Democrat convention, and right now, Trump being not too far from here, having some kind of trouble. You basically need that guaranteed capacity for live news coverage, of live sports coverage, and that's something that open caching is uniquely well-placed to be able to offer. Guarantee contractually capacity at specific time, making sure that you have the right capacity in place to reach the eyeballs. So now, that was the intro. I tried to go very fast. Let's talk about the fun stuff. Everything we learn, all the lesson learned by deploying those big sports league to deploying those big US OTT service, all of that, there's a lot of things that we fine-tune over the course of the year, the last 12 months, and that those are the lessons. So one of the things we learned to leverage even more is one of the core concepts of open caching. You mentioned me saying it was a partnership with the ISP. It's a partnership in several ways. One, we share the CDN revenue with the ISP. So initially, up until a couple of years ago, you had the CDN, the content provider, the CDN, and the ISP, and everyone was fighting. You've seen all the court cases around, you know, people suing Netflix, ISP suing Netflix, and those video platforms, because ISPs are always saying, you're sending us more video, you're sending us higher quality, higher bitrate, and you don't pay, you don't invest in our network. Right, that was always the big fight. ISP say, you want me to deliver 4 8K, but you're not paying me to expand my pipes, right? So open caching changed that by basically doing almost 50-50 revenue sharing with the ISPs, which means that when a Disney of the world pays me to deliver Disney Plus within Verizon, half of the money goes to Verizon. So for the very first time, you have a paradigm shift where the three main players of the delivery ecosystem, the content creator, the CDN, and the ISP, have a vested and financial interest into making sure that delivery is successful, right? And so we always had a little bit of ISP assistance because they were, you know, when you need to deploy 400 POPs within Verizon, we don't know where to put those, right? So we need Verizon to tell us, based on our network, here's the best place to put those POPs so that it's the most efficient possible, right? And then our collaboration on my side, on the content side, was kind of stopped that way. They help us do the architecture. As we started doing like those very big games with millions and millions of concurrent users, we realized we could use the ISP in different ways. And one of the key way we did was using them for support during the event. When you have like iron glass support during a big football game, basketball game, soccer game, whatever you want, the fact that you're gonna have on a call the content team from the OTT platform, the CDN team, and the ISP is gonna make a big difference in debugging, right? If there's anything happening, you're gonna have visibility end-to-end to the people's house. So from the content creation to my doorstep when the fiber comes to my home, right? Even to the modem inside my house, actually. So we had some issues initially where in Brazil, IPv6 requests were disappearing. We could not. And thanks to the ISP being on the call, we realized that they were never reaching our servers because they had an ISP routing issue that prevented IPv6 to arrive to the open caching. We were able to debug that during the first 10 minutes of the game, put a fix in place, and continue the event. That would not be possible within the engagement of the ISPs. So that's something that we are cultivating a lot, making sure that we involve the ISP in all those big events, those big releases from, we did Baldur's Gate with Steam, making sure that when there's a big video game download or a big live event, they're engaged. So they're giving us support, they're giving us observability. You know, as I mentioned, the ability to see up until the people's modem brings a lot of value in debugging. And we also started cultivating those monthly meeting with them where we explain what's about to happen. We share the planning, they share us their upgrade, what they're doing on the network, and that's helping a lot. So first big lesson we learned this year is involve them in the design, in the proof of concept. Every CDN has to do a proof of concept. We all know that, right? It's part of the game. So have them within the proof of concept to showcase the value that they bring to the customers, and then in production. The second thing we work on that was really, really, really key is when you're having all those networks, right, like separate ISP networks all over the US or all over the world, how can you guarantee cache efficiency, right? That was a key aspect of things we did this year, making sure we work really hard on optimizing our cache efficiency across multiple ISPs, multiple deployment. We have several hundreds of deployment now, so making sure we optimize that. And the way we have some of our product people in the room, the way we found that is a layered mid-tier architecture. So what that means is that you're going to have your edge nodes within Verizon, as my example. Then you're going to have your mid-tiers within Verizon. And then we started expanding the network and had those what we call global POPs that are POPs outside of traditional ISPs, right, that are going to be in like traditional data centers, that are going to role, they are going to play the role of being able to deliver content for users that don't, that come from an ISP that does not have an open caching deployment, right? So I mentioned we have hundreds of ISP, but if you come from an ISP that doesn't have that deployment, you're going to be served for those traditional CDN POPs that we call global POPs in a traditional Equinix data center, for example. And then secondly, those are going to be a second layer of mid-tier. So you're going to have parents, grandparents, right? You're going to have a first layer of mid-tiers that increase cache efficiency within the ISP deployment, and then you're going to have a second layer within those global POPs, right? The entire goal is making sure we're on par with the best platform with 99% cache efficiency, making sure that, especially with what we're seeing from the cloud platform lately, the egress cost that they charge you to go from your storage bucket to your CDN, make sure that we don't increase your cost or that you don't get a double bill, basically, right? So very important part of our work. I already talked about that a little bit, but that's kind of like the core concept now in a more digestible diagram, the ability that we have to have multiple level of shielding from the local ISPs, outside of the ISP. We protect your origin. We make sure we pull the content only a handful of time, or the best case scenario, only one time. But we make sure that we don't slam your origin and don't create all those additional costs. The other thing that we worked on is the ability or ability to handle failure, like hardware failure or server failure or POP failure better. And the design that we have within open caching is very specific, which means that unlike traditional CDN, when you're going to have a POP in Denver, and if the POP in Denver dies, there's a connectivity issue or somebody took the fiber out of the ground, right? You're going to be served from LA, or you're going to be served from Texas, or you're going to be served from somewhere else, right? Due to the way we build, the density of POPs we put within a single ISP, I mentioned Verizon 400 POP within Verizon broadband. If one of those POPs goes down, there's 399 POPs still available to deliver the content. You're still getting served from a POP that is extremely close to you within the Verizon network. So the redundancy in case of hardware failure or fiber issues, all of that, is by design much, much, much stronger that traditional CDN. And over the course of this year, when we did all those big OTT service, all those big live events, we had some like everyone, you know, there's outages for everyone, except that those outages, due to the architecture, the original design of open caching, are not being felt by the customer. You don't see a dip in your KPIs, in your client-side analytics. It remains the same because one down, 399 to go, all right? We have also the ability to, within an ISP, we have location within multiple cities. So let's say an entire city has fiber issues, connectivity issues, you can still deliver from within an ISP from another city, and it's still gonna be faster than leaving the network and coming back, all right? Bottom line, we put a lot of time now with all the lesson we learned with those terabits per second of live event, like, tens, 20 terabits per second events, making sure that we had our redundancy in place so that anything that would happen, any outage, would not impact the customer experience. And by design, open caching is the best design to do that. All right. The other thing we did is had a lot of tools, a lot of tools. I touched base on that in the beginning, but there's a few that I'd like to underline because they are extremely cool. So obviously you have all your logging, your key and certificate management. All of that now is done via API. So very transparent, very easy. You use the API to upload your cert and your key and all of that. You have a full set of API and dashboard reporting that our product team has been working really, really hard on. Actually, they've been able to use tools now like Snowflake that allows you to get more real-time insights into our platform. So, typically CDN had like a sample set that you could see immediately, and then you needed to wait 24 hours to get the full extent of the analytics. Now it's much, much faster thanks to those new tools. You have self-service API, so you can provision your configuration, modify your configuration, deploy new configuration on a per ISP basis or a per country basis as fast as you can click the button, basically. The billing and the configuration. Now, there's one more thing. I don't know why it's coming back. There you go. Okay. One more thing that is very cool in terms of like the SVTA tool, and I know one of the architects is in the room of that, it's the capacity interface. So capacity interface is something that blew my mind as someone who's been working CDN for like 17 years now. CDN are typically very, very secretive about not the capacity they deploy, but the capacity they have available. You always say, like, we have 100 terabits per second of capacity available within our network, but you don't know how much of that is being used. And even better, you don't know how much of that is being used at that instant. Because the fact that you have 100 terabytes doesn't mean you have 100 terabits per second when it's Tuesday and you have iOS update, Windows update, the Champions League, and the NBA at the same time. Right? So the capacity API is the very first API that gives you the capacity available per deployment in real time. So you're using Akamai, you're seeing a downgrade of your KPI within, let's say, Charter this time, right? You can query that API and say, hey, right now, how much capacity do you have available if I want to load balance traffic to you at Charter? And the API is going to instantly reply, I got 3.5 terabits per second that I'm being unused right now. You can send us that much, right? So that kind of transparency, and that's where the term open caching comes back, right? Kind of like open caching, open source, open transparency. That's where all of that comes together, because we give you the list of deployment, the location of the deployment, and the capacity available in real time that you can integrate within your load balancer, and the load balancer can do an API query before deciding to send us traffic or not, right? So that's mind-blowing, because no other platform on the planet does that and share their capacity available. And then the configuration interface API is something we talked about. It's the ability to do self-service. It is now widely adopted. It makes things much easier. And you can also, that basically allows you to have a unique configuration file that you push across multiple CDN, right? All the different open caching vendors. And you can basically have one configuration that you deployed across multiple vendor. And I know there's a big push within SVTA to try to get traditional commercial CDN to adopt that also, so that you have a single configuration file that you can push to Akamai, Fastly, AWS, Google Cloud, Qwilt, all those guys with just one single configuration. All right, the last part, the last evolution that we've seen this year is since the beginning of open caching, typically the ISPs were saying, well, if you deploy within my network, if you deploy within me, Verizon, I want my open caching node to be only used for Verizon subscribers, okay? I am not opening my peering to Comcast. I am not opening my peering to Charter. I am not letting Comcast users connect to my open caching that is on my network. I'm not letting you guys do that, right? There were a few exceptions. This morning, that amazing lady from Z5 was talking about Airtel. Airtel was one of the first deployment that we did at Qwilt of open caching, where they let us they let other viewers in India, not on the Airtel network, use their open caching node to deploy content, right? Now, the transition that we're seeing now over the last few months is that we're seeing more and more ISPs we say, you know what? We're gonna open up. Like the latest example that we're working on is in Argentina, where one Argentinian ISP that had a private deployment is now considering opening that deployment to all the viewers in Argentina, which increases the user experience for every single viewers within Argentina, even though they're not on that specific network, right? So that's the last big evolution that we saw this year that's happening right now. This ability for ISPs to say, even though it's my nodes, it's my deployment, I'm gonna open it to more people. Actually, it makes business sense for them because you remember at the beginning, I talked about the revenue share. The revenue share is calculated out of the bandwidth that leave their servers, those open caching servers. So if they open to more ISPs that connect to those servers, they get more traffic, so they get more revenue. All right? Last part, it's my last slide. The other thing that we've seen this year that changed is now that the ISP make money and revenue out of that, they've been actively involved in making sure OTT service get more subscribers, right? I was talking about the NCTC, that association of smaller ISP. They want more revenue, they want more traffic on their server. So now they're gonna advertise service. They're gonna say, well, if you're Sling, if you're PBS, if you're ESPN, we're gonna advertise your service on our bills, on our portal, on our mobile application, and we're gonna make sure that you can acquire more subscriber thanks to us, because at the end, more subscribers on my network means more traffic, means more revenue for me. So we can offer that, ISPs now offer that kind of like bundled promotion that doesn't cost anything to the content provider. That's basically the only condition is that you have to use those nodes to deliver your content. That's it. If you deliver those nodes, the ISP are starting to throw buckets of marketing for free because they want you to get more subscribers within their subscriber base. Okay. Also, the last thing that we say on that topic is for them, it's also very advantageous because the more OTT service you subscribe to, the more likely you're going to upgrade your connectivity at home, right? If you only have one Netflix subscription, you typically can do with DSL and you're good to go. But if your kid starts getting a Disney Plus, if I'm watching the presidential campaign on a news feed, if somebody else is watching Netflix, all of that, then that allows that ISP to upgrade you for their connectivity. So it's a win-win, like it's a virtuous flywheel. More subscribers, more OTT service, more connectivity, everyone is happy. All right? So, as a conclusion, I think I have 3 minutes to take questions, if you have any. And I'm very much looking forward to answer your question after that. I'll be obviously at the happy hour. Being French, you see, I need to do that to make sure I keep my passport, drinking wine. But I'll be more than happy to answer questions. Yes? Absolutely. So we're seeing on top of like our typical focus of large ISPs, we're deploying within university network, and we're deploying also nodes right now. We have actually our first couple of use cases within enterprise network for their internal video communication, both live and on demand. So that's absolutely something we're doing, yes. Any other question? No? Oh, well, I will see you. Oh, yes. Very good question. So in 1 minute, I would say that every single big provider that we signed, content provider, we had to go through the proof of concept measured by client-side analytics, right? So a Conviva, a Nice People at Work that measures the KPI that I mentioned, time to first frame, average bitrate watch, session without rebuffering, all of that. So the answer is within every ISP that we have a deployment in, we're crushing it. We're better. We're better than an Akamai. Because, I mean, it's not that we're smarter. Look at me. I don't look smarter than any of you guys. But it's genuinely because we're much closer. We're sub 5 milliseconds to the end user, it's gonna be a better video experience. That's one. For ISPs where we're not deployed, we're on par with the Akamai. We're not better. Like, to be very transparent, the ISPs where we don't have a deployment that we deliver from global POPs, we're gonna be on par with the Fastly of the world and the Akamai. The product people in the room that work on those deployments are all ex-Fastly or ex-Akamai people. So they tend to take the same data center, you know, in the same city. So it's not better, it's on par. But our value, really, the reason people work with us is that ability to be deeper within the ISP and provide much better KPIs. And then one other thing I want to add, and then I'll shut up. Yeah, I'm done. It's basically, we're talking about the US right now, but now apply those deployments that we're doing in India, in Latin America, in Southeast Asia. Like, we're not talking about a 7% improvement. Like Brazil, we're talking about a 42% improvement of all those key metrics, right? Because the harder it is to deliver content outside of the US, the better those nodes will perform, all right? Thank you for your time. I look forward to seeing you at Happy Hour, hopefully.